You've put in the hard work of optimizing your website's page speed. Now what? How do you make sure you don't introduce a change that causes you to take a step back? In this video, I'm going to go over one way you can do this by adding Google Lighthouse Audits to your build process. Hi, I'm Phil Sparks with Guiding Digital. In previous videos, we've talked about the many benefits of web performance and even talked about free tools available to help you audit and optimize web pages. One of these tools was Google's Lighthouse Audit. In today's video, I want to walk through how easy it is to add Lighthouse Audits to your build process. I'll be hosting my repo in GitHub and using some of their built-in CI/CD features, but many of the concepts apply to other Git providers or CI/CD setups. So let's get into our demo. As a starting point, I've created a out-of-the-box Gatsby site using the Gatsby new command, and then I've pushed that up to my GitHub repo.
If you're wanting to follow along, you don't have to use Gatsby. You can use whatever framework that you'd like to use. If you're not familiar with Gatsby, I'll include a link to their Getting Started page in the video description. Before we add our action to our project, let's create a local Git branch to work off of. I'm using Visual Studio Code as my code editor and using their built-in terminal and PowerShell to run my Git commands. Now let's add our GitHub action to our project. GitHub actions are, of course, specific to GitHub. I'm not going to go into too much detail about GitHub actions, but for this video, just know that GitHub actions are GitHub's way of allowing you to build continuous integration and continuous deployment into your project. If you're not using GitHub, other Git providers offer similar solutions, and you can use tools like Jenkins as well to accomplish the same thing. To add the action to our project, we first create a directory called .github to the root of our project. And then we create a directory called workflows inside of that directory. And then we'll add our GitHub action to the workflows directory. The name isn't important, but we'll name ours lighthouseaction.yaml. Now let's add our code for our default action. I'm going to go ahead and copy and paste the code in so you don't have to watch me type. A lot of what I'm using for today's demo is from the Lighthouse CI's project page, including this code that I just copied in. So if you need to refer back to that, I'll include a link in the video description to that page. We won't go over every single detail of the action code, but let me just point out a few things. The first thing I'll point out is the on attribute. This is where you can configure what events you want to trigger the action. For example, you could tell it to trigger an action on push events or pull request events. You can also tell it what branches will trigger the action. And so you could tell it to only trigger the action for pull requests against the master branch. The next section I'll point out is the steps section. This is basically where you just outline what you want the action to do. The important parts of this section are the part where you see here the npm install build step. And in that step is where you basically tell it how to build your application. And so I'm using Yarn for my dependency management. So I'm running the Yarn command to solve my dependencies and then do a npm run build to do a Gatsby build. The next section is actually where the Lighthouse code is run. You'll see it installs the Lighthouse dependencies and then calls a LHCI auto run, which actually will then run the report. Now let's commit our changes and push it up to the remote. Now we'll create a pull request. And then we see our action running. We can click on the detailed link to see each step in the process. I'm going to go ahead and skip to the end and show you the results. Okay, the action has completed, and you'll see that Lighthouse ran for two URLs that it found in the out-of-the-box Gatsby site, the 404 page and the default home page. You'll see that it ran Lighthouse three times for each URL, and then it uses the average from those three runs to report back. To view the results, you can copy the URL you see here in the output and copy it and paste it into a browser. And you see a normal Google Lighthouse report. Now, obviously, it's a little difficult to get to the actual report. So the next step we're going to take is adding what's called GitHub status checks. And that'll make it easier to view the results directly from the pull request. So the first thing we're going to do to add the status checks is we're going to install and authorize the Lighthouse CI GitHub app. You can find a link to the app in the Lighthouse CI's project page, or I'll include a link in the video description. To install the app, simply go to the page and hit the install button. And then I've chosen to only allow my specific repo. And then click the Install and Authorize button. On this next page, make sure and copy this token to your clipboard. You'll need it in the next step. Next, we're going to go back to our repo and go to the Settings section. Then we're going to go to the Secrets section and add the token that we just copied. So we're going to paste it here in the value field and then give it a name. And then click the Add Secret button to save it. Now we're going to switch back to Visual Studio Code and then add a section to our last step for including an environment variable. And just make sure the name that you use on the right side when referring to the setting is the same name you gave it in the previous step. Okay, now let's commit our changes and push them up to our remote repo. Then we'll go back to GitHub and go back to the pull request and open our previous pull request. And we see that the action is running again. Click in the details tab to see the details. And again, I'm going to forward to the end and we'll see the end results. It is now completed and you'll see here it mentions the status checks. We'll go back to the pull request and open it up and see that they added the checks. And you can easily see the summary of each of the categories. And then you can click on the details button to go directly to the report. So it's so much easier than the first method.
Now let's take it one step further. Let's add some test assertions to fail the checks if any of the categories fall below 90. To modify the Lighthouse CI settings, you just add a file named .lighthouserc.json to the root of your project. And then you add your configuration to that file. In this code that I've copied in, I've set up assertions that will throw an error for any of the four main categories if the score falls below 90. If you remember from my video on performance tools, the Lighthouse performance score is calculated from five different metrics. First contentful paint, speed index, time to interactive, first meaningful paint, and first CPU idle. And out of those, it gives the most weight to the time to interactive weight. And so one way you could do it is you could configure your assertions to set individual goals for each of these metrics if you wanted. Or if you just wanted to focus on the most important one, the time to interactive, you could just set up an assertion for that one as well. I'm not going to go over all the different options of configuring assertions in this video, but the Lighthouse CI's products README page has some pretty good documentation and guidance on these options. The last thing we're going to do is go back to our action YAML file. We're going to remove the configuration options from the command line here since we moved it to our Lighthouse RC JSON file. Okay, now let's commit our changes and push them up one more time. And then we'll go back to our pull request and go to the details. And skipping forward again. Once the Lighthouse run has completed, we see that our assertions have ran and everything passed.
In today's video, we created a working example that I hope gives you some ideas on how you can implement a solution to continually monitor your web page performance. Remember, you don't have to use the exact pieces that I've used today. Mix and match technologies for the different pieces of your solution based on what you are familiar with and what works for your environment. The question of the day is, what tools have you used to monitor web page performance? Thanks for watching today. If you found this video useful, give me a like and make sure and subscribe if you want more content on web best practices. Also, feel free to leave me a comment or question below, and I'll try to respond to each one.